is the system of measurement we will be using all semester, which is why it's really important that we have a good foundation on the metric system, because that's the only unit system that we'll be studying. So before we begin, let's refresh our memory on scientific notation. We're going to use scientific notation a lot, especially today. So we use very large numbers or very small numbers to represent in this format. Okay? I don't like seeing a big long string of zeros after something or in front of something. We like a nice, short, concise number. All right, we don't need all those zeros. So we use this format. We put the decimal in between the first two digits. Okay? So the decimal needs to go here, not here, not here, not here. It needs to be digit, decimal, and then the rest of your numbers. And then you say times 10 to the whatever. Now, how do you get this number? This little number comes from the number of spaces you would have to move the decimal to get it where it needs to be. All right? So, for instance, if I'm writing 4,300 as a decimal and as a scientific notation, right? The decimal is currently here. It needs to be here. So I need to move it 1, 2, 3 places, which is why it's 4.3 times 10 to the third. Okay? Notice it's not 43 times 10 to the second or 0.43 times 10 to the fourth. The decimal goes between the first two non-zero digits. Okay, right there. Now, on your calculator, I want to point out your calculator has a button that will enter that exponent for you. Okay, this is the calculator that I have. It comes from our bookstore, but you can get it at a zillion other places too. This is the TI-30XA. If you have this calculator, there's a button right here. It's called EE. Right, so if I'm trying to enter 4.3 times 10 to the third, for instance, I would type 4.3E3, and then you get a little superscript. Right? That's entering that number in scientific notation. The calculator knows that that E stands for the times 10 to the part. So that way you don't have to enter times 10 exponent whatever. Right? You just say 4.3E and then whatever that exponent is. Okay? Now, if you've got a other brands like Casio, it might be slightly different button labeling. So if you have a question on which button it is on your calculator, I'll be happy to show you. But I know most of you have Texas Instruments ones, so just use this E button. Easy enough. Okay, now remember, when do we have a negative exponent and when do we have a positive exponent? If it's a large number, we have a positive exponent because we're moving the decimal this way, right? If it's a small number less than 1, right, we're going to have a negative exponent. So we're moving the decimal this way, right? So if you have 0.0534, the decimal needs to go right here between the 5 and 3, so that's 1, 2. I'm moving it this direction, that's why it's a negative exponent. Now you'll see me write out things in calculator language in this class all the time, because I just get lazy, right? I don't get tired of writing the times 10 to the whatever. So you can use this format too if you want. If you, instead of writing this, you want to write this, that's fine, right? Because you're putting it in calculator language, so to say. Now just remember you're using uppercase E, not lowercase E. Lowercase E is something very, very different. All right? But that's scientific notation. So take a second and do these two on your paper. Write them in scientific notation. Just to make sure you remember it. You gotta be good at scientific notation. Where does the decimal need to go? Where does the decimal need to go? In front of the first one? Where this comma is? Here? Right? It goes between the two ones, correct? Because it's always digit, decimal, and then the rest of your digits. So this would be 1.1 times 10 to the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We agree? 1.162 times 10 to the 7. And then here, this one, is it going to have a positive exponent or a negative exponent? Negative, right? Because the decimal needs to go this direction. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? The decimal needs to be between the 3 and the 8. So 3.874 times 10 to the negative 5th. And again, you can use this uppercase E format. That's fine. It's just like what you would do when you're typing it into your calculator. 1.162E7 is the same thing as this in your calculator. We good on scientific notation? Yes? Okay, so we call these orders of magnitude, right? A power of 10. Sometimes you hear this word, oh, that's four orders of magnitude larger, four orders of magnitude smaller. What does that mean? Each one of those, you're multiplying by the power of 10, right? So 10 to the 0, that's just 1. 10 to the 1st is 10, 10 to the 2nd is 100, 10 to the 3rd is 1,000, 10 to the 6th is 1,000,000, right? So those are all getting bigger, and then these would all be getting smaller. 10 to the negative 1st, that's 1 over 10, 10 to the negative 2, 1 over 10 times 1 over 10, right? So these are all getting smaller. So the metric system is centered around base units. And then, the nice thing about the metric system is now all you have to do is add a prefix to make it bigger or to make it smaller. You don't ever have to worry about remembering trivial stuff like how many fluid ounces are in a gallon. Well, I don't really care, right? Unless I'm baking and I need to know exactly, I don't know, when you need a gallon or something when you're baking, but beside the point, right? You're not going to memorize how many X's are in Y, right? Because the unit is going to stay the same. The only thing you have to remember is what prefix goes in front of it, and the quantity associated with that. And the quantity is always going to be a factor of 10, right? It's always going to be 10 to the something. So I'm showing you the most simplified way I can come up with on how to make the metric system most manageable. Okay, so this is very different from what we see in the U.S. So here are the base units. These are the ones you're responsible for knowing, and these are the units that we will be using in lab. Mass is measured in the gram. Why do I say mass, not weight? Are they the same thing? No, what's the difference between mass and weight? When I stand on the back of the scale, that's measuring my weight. That's not measuring my mass. What's the difference? Does anyone remember? Mass is a measure of how much me is there, right? That's mass. Weight is a measure of how hard am I pushing down, right? Weight is a force. So weight is going to is a function of gravity. If I go to the moon, my weight's going to be lower. If I go to moon, my mass is going to be the same, right? So mass is a measure of how much, whereas weight is actually a force. How hard are you pushing down? How hard is gravity pulling on you? Right? That's why we don't use the pound or anything like that. Volume is in the liter, uppercase L. Length slash distance, right? That's the meter. Temperature is in Kelvin, that's uppercase K. All right, and all my thermometers are actually Celsius thermometers. So all the experiments we'll be doing involving temperature, we're measuring temperature in Celsius, but it's easy enough to convert to Kelvin. Time is in seconds, and then the amount of substance, we won't do this one today, is in mole. Just to give you a frame of reference on a meter, right, because some of you may not be familiar with a meter, right, you might be familiar with a yardstick, right, but this is a meter stick, and conveniently, my meter stick comes like pretty much directly to my belly button, right, so if you're about as tall as I am, that's where a meter hits you, right about there, right? So this is what a meter looks like. That's the base unit of length. Now, are you going to have a meter's worth of something in this class? That's a lot. It's probably not going to be a meter long. So we're going to use a prefix that would indicate a smaller version of this. Any questions on the base units? Okay, so how do I know if I'm dealing with a base unit or a unit that's been modified with a prefix to make it bigger or smaller? Well, the way you do that is you just look at the symbol, okay, and ask yourself, is this symbol one letter or is it two letters? So if it's just one letter, with the exception of the mole, but we're not doing the mole today, so that doesn't matter. If it's just one letter, and you go, oh, okay, that's the base unit. So that's, for instance, G. There's no prefix, plain old G. So that means, okay, that's base. So that means I'm just talking about a gram. gram. You can see a gram in your hand, right? If I put a gram of sand, that's a quantity that's easy to see. If I put a picogram of something in your hand, you can't see that. If I put a megagram, you can't hold that. So gram is something you can see in your hand. That's the base unit. Now, if it's two letters, that means it's a modified base unit. So for instance, this prefix now, that's been modified. That's a milligram. Do we see the difference between how to tell if it's modified or if it's just a regular old base unit, right? No prefix, base unit. Prefix means it's been modified, right? Meter, straight up by itself, one letter. Millimeter, modified. Makes sense? Okay. So prefixes are going to indicate if something's been made bigger or smaller. So if I'm using distance as my reference, right? Would I measure the length of this room in kilometers? If I'm measuring the length from that wall to that wall, that would be ridiculous, right? Probably not. If I measure the distance from here to my house, would kilometer be useful? Yes, that would. Would I measure the distance from this wall in millimeters? By the way, a millimeter is a thousandth of one of these, so one of the tiniest little tick marks out here, right? That would be millimeters. I wouldn't want to measure this room in millimeters, and I certainly want to measure it in picometers. Picometers, that would be the unit we use to measure the width of an atom, right? When we're measuring how big is an atom, we're using picometers, so we definitely wouldn't want to use picometers to measure this room, right? We just use regular meters, that'd be fine. Right? But a prefix tells us how we made it bigger, how we made it smaller. And we're going to be using conversion factors to convert from one unit to the other. Okay? And the way you set this up is you always write a conversion factor so that the unit you want is on the top and the unit you have that you want to get rid of is on the bottom. And then you just multiply straight across and divide up. Oops. Multiply straight across and divide up. So now we're going to get into the metric chart. And I'm just going to do this on the board so that you have plenty of time to write it down. I don't go too fast. Let's see if I can do this stealthily here. Give my online students the true, authentic experience. Alright, we'll see how that works. Okay, so we are going to list out our metric prefixes. Now guys, when you're writing this stuff in your notes, just put a big, like, learn. Okay? This is something you gotta learn. And I put learn instead of memorize, right? Because memorize implies that you're gonna forget. Right? I memorized this phone number long enough to enter it in my phone. Learn is long term. Okay, so we have to get really, really good at the metric system. So I've tried over the semesters to come up with all different kinds of ways to remember my metric prefixes, and some are more successful than others. This is the current iteration of cute little ways to remember the prefixes. If you come up with a better one, I'm very open to hear it. So here's the current one. Kale, and then draw a line. Talk about the line in a minute. Dinners, cost, me, money, and patience. Nothing against kale. I think kale is very healthy food. But have you ever eaten raw kale, just straight up? It's not the most delicious food, right? So to make that into a gourmet meal that's just, oh, this is wonderful tasting kale, right? That's going to take money because you're going to have to add nice ingredients to it, and it's going to take some patience because cooking greens can sometimes be a laborious process. So this is my current iteration of prefixes memorization method. I used to use kindly do call mom most nights please. That one didn't stick so well, so now we're on to kale. If you come up with one and you think that it's easy to remember, please share it. I'll give you a couple bonus points for it. How about that? So what does this all stand for? Now notice I made an important note that that's lowercase k, not to be confused with the uppercase K, which is Kelvin, right? So that's why I wrote it in cursive. So K stands for kilo, and the symbol for that is lowercase k. D stands for deci, lowercase d. C stands for centi, lowercase c. M stands for milli, lowercase m. Other M stands for micro, and now we're going, well, we've already got lowercase m in use. We have to use a different one for our micro. It's actually the Greek letter mu. Okay? Like, what does cow say? That's lowercase mu, by the way. Uppercase mu is just cow letter. N, and, that stands for nano, lowercase n, and P stands for pico, lowercase p. Okay, now we need to deal with the numeric values. This line right here that we drew, this is base. Okay, so that's where there's no prefix. Because base has no prefix, right? So that's where you have meters, grams, liters, etc. And the number associated with base is 1. Okay? The number associated with that line is 1. So now just make yourself a string of 10s. Because remember, these are all based on powers of 10. So 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, and 10. Okay, now, last part to making our chart is filling in the exponents, right? Because the metric system prefixes are based on powers of 10. So, if you have them listed like this, nice and linear, the exponents are actually really easy to remember. So the only one with a negative exponent is kilo, and it's negative 3, 10 to the negative third. Now the value of base is 1, so we don't have to put anything there. Then we're gonna do 10 to the first, so 1, 2, 3, and then count by threes. So 6, 9, 12. 1, 2, 3, 6, 9, 12. Now, obviously, there are other prefixes other than these, but these are the only ones we're going to deal with. Notice there's like mega and giga and tera. We're not going to deal with masses that huge or volumes that huge in this class, right? We're not going to deal with teraliters. That's an insane unit to measure volume in our classroom, right? But we will use milliliters or milliliters. So what does 10 to the negative third mean? Well, that's the same thing as 0.001, right? 10 to the first, that just means 10. 10 to the second, what's that? That's 100. 10 to the third would be 1,000. 10 to the sixth is 1,000,000. 10 to the ninth is 1,000,000,000. And 10 to the 12th is 1,000,000,000,000. So what does all this mean? Well, 1 meter is 1,000,000,000,000 picometers, right? 1 meter is 100 centimeters. 1 meter is 0.001 kilometers. So this number, how many of these are into one of those? So now all we have to do is set up a conversion factor, and we're off to the races. Does this make sense? So if you don't need to remember how to list it all out, because you can enter those exponents in your calculator.
Just making sure I'm still in the frame here. Oh, it's blurry. Boy, that makes me crazy. Oh, well.
Doing the best you can. Okay, so let's do some conversion factors. So we can convert between units. Now, once you get good at this, you'll be able to do it in your head. Right? You'll be able to just go, oh, move the decimal 3, move the decimal 5, whatever. Because that's all you're doing. When you're dividing by 10 or dividing by 1,000 or dividing by 1,000,000, you're just moving the decimal place. But until you have this down, I recommend that you make some conversion factors. So let's do an example. Convert, millimeters to meters. I erased my prefixes. Kindly, you, mom, most nice, please, boy. Kale dinner's costing me money and patience. After you do that one, do this one. Convert, let's see, 5.0 liters to milliliters.